Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn.
Biblical hope is rooted in who God is, not on the circumstances that are swirling around us.
Even if we feel we can barely hold on to hope, Christ is holding on to us.
And if through teaching them and enhancing their basketball skills, we can also teach them the love of Jesus Christ.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay.
Many of us can recall Christmas Eve as a child, beside ourselves with excitement about the one gift we had set our heart on. But even if we received what we had hoped for, it didn't always meet our expectations. In this message, Brett McBride illustrates how the biblical understanding of hope is not based on circumstances, but on the faithfulness of God in history. Biblical hope is always connected to waiting. Waiting for God to fulfill His word. At the time Jesus was born, there were many who had waited a long time for their Messiah to come, and He was their hope. This is Living Truth.
Good morning, church. Hope is born. Hope out of the darkness. Hope, the long-awaited hope of the world. Israel had been waiting for generation after generation after generation for this promise to be fulfilled. Hope is here. Every day for the last number of weeks, I've been driving up to our church, and there's that massive sign out front that says, "Hope is here," and it's such a good reminder to remember what Christmas is all about. Last night I was going over my notes at about 9:30 in preparation. I had just tucked our boys into bed. And we were settling down for the evening, and I heard a large group of people moving outside around my property. And I live in Scarborough, so when you hear a large group of people at 9:30 at night and it's dark out, walking by your home, you casually walk over to the window and as inconspicuously as possible, look through the curtains and go, what is going on out there? And then I was surprised by a message of hope as a multitude of voices were raised and people started to sing Christmas carols to bless our family. And one of my sons came out of their room. They had just been tucked in, and they go, what's going on outside? And I said, someone's out there caroling. And he goes, are you going to go tell them to be quiet? And I put on my jacket, and I stepped outside, and it was Len and the international student ministries that were singing carols to our family. And it was just such a beautiful reminder that hope is here. What I want to look at this morning is the whole concept of hope, because we have a cultural lens through which we perceive and talk about the whole idea of hope. And I want to look at what our culture thinks about hope, and then I want to understand what the Bible means when it talks about hope. So if you have your Bible, please turn to Psalm chapter 130. We're going to be looking at that passage in a few moments. But again, we're looking at our cultural understanding that influences our viewpoint at times. What does our culture mean when it says hope? And what does the Bible mean when it talks about hope? Now, I looked up the Merriam-Webster definition of hope, and it says this: to cherish a desire with anticipation, to desire with expectation of obtainment or fulfillment, to expect with confidence or trust. And so hope is looking forward to something taking place, and you can cherish a desire. You may want something to happen. You may be even confident that it will happen, and to expect it with confidence. But hope in our world sometimes seems elusive because it may or may not happen. I hope that the Toronto Maple Leafs will win the Stanley Cup this year. And someone fueled that hope earlier this year when they predicted that Toronto would win the Stanley Cup. Do you believe that they will? You may desire something. You may cherish a desire. You may expect it with confidence. You might be wearing your jersey now, lining up for the parade. Does that mean it's going to happen? Well, we can't be certain. I hope that the Toronto Raptors win the NBA championship. Is it going to happen? Well, we don't know, but I hope so. And sometimes we speak of hope this way. I hope that on Christmas Eve, during our 2, 4, 6, 8, isn't Christmas Eve really great services? I hope that my children are well behaved at that service, because we're going to have all the children and grandchildren here, and I hope that they'll be well behaved. But that may or may not happen. I worked with inner city youth for 17 years, and many of the youth that I worked with came from lone parent families, oftentimes a single mother. And I remember whenever young people's birthday or Christmas would come around, fathers would promise their children that they were going to be there for their birthday or for Christmas and that they would be bringing a gift. And I remember youth who had hope. They were certain that their father was going to show up. They were certain because he had promised that he would. I remember all their hopes and dreams put into the fact that he was going to show up on their birthday or Christmas, and oftentimes disappointed when he didn't show up. They had placed their hope. It wasn't for lack of confidence. It wasn't for lack of expectation, but their hopes were dashed to the ground. And so we bring this experiential perspective to our understanding of hope when we read the Bible. And we're not so sure about this whole hope thing because we've experienced disappointment in our lives. We were confident, we were trusting, but it didn't come to pass. And sometimes that colors when we read about hope and proclaim that hope is here. So what I want to do is dive into Scripture and get a biblical understanding of what we mean by the word hope. And I want to answer two questions. What is biblical hope, and what is our hope based on? In the Old Testament, there were two main words for hope. They were the word yakal and kavah. Yakal was to wait for, or simply waiting, and kavah was a tense expectation while you wait for something to happen. Now, it's important for us to understand from the start of this and recognize that the whole idea of hope and waiting are interrelated. They are interconnected. Waiting is hope. We don't hope for what we already have. We wait for it expectantly. So these words, yakal and kavah, waiting and hope, were almost interchangeable throughout the Old Testament. When you read the word wait, it is oftentimes yakal or kavah, or you read the word hope, it is yakal or kavah. They were interrelated. So for an example, Noah had to wait for the waters to recede when God flooded the earth. He had to yakal for the waters to recede after God had flooded the earth. In fact, he had to wait for approximately 370 days. He was sitting inside the ark waiting for the floodwaters to recede. But when we look at that passage in Genesis, when we study that passage in its context, we see something that helps us understand biblical hope. His yakal, Noah's hope, his waiting, was rooted in a promise from God that the waters would recede. And this is the pattern that we observe in the Old Testament. Biblical hope is rooted in God's faithfulness. Over 40 times in the book of Psalms, yakal and kavah are used. And Psalm 130 gives us a bit of an understanding about this whole idea of waiting and hoping and how they're interconnected. In Psalm 130, verse 5, we read this: I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits. And in his word, I put my hope. I wait for the Lord. More than watchmen wait for the morning. More than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord. For with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. The slide that we're throwing up here shows the posture with which the author waits. He is saying, I yakal for the Lord. My whole being yakals. And in his word, I put my kavah. So he is waiting expectantly. There is a tense expectation that God will move. Now look at the exact same verse with a flip as to what the object of his hope is. I wait for what? I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word, I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than a watchman waits for the morning, more than the watchman wait for the morning. Israel, put your kavah in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. Biblical hope is secure because it depends upon God. It's not focused on circumstances or events taking place around us, but rather on who God is. The prophets are great examples of this biblical concept of hope. The prophets were surrounded by tumultuous times, foreign armies invading, and they would be sharing their prophecies, and they could share about the future of Israel. They could share about the coming of the Messiah with hope, with expectant fulfillment. They could share about all those things because their hope was rooted in the faithfulness of God. God's past faithfulness to his people enabled them to have hope for the future. Biblical hope is rooted in who God is, and it takes comfort and has confidence in his past faithfulness, that the God who has delivered me will watch over me. And so the prophets displayed this type of hope. Mary and Joseph, as they're fleeing to Egypt, probably recalled how God raised up Moses and delivered his people. They could recall his faithfulness to his covenant people when they were enduring difficult circumstances. They could recall that David overcame Goliath, even though from the outside it shouldn't have happened. God brought about a great deliverance for his people when David slew Goliath. And that might have proved some comfort for them. That might have given them hope when they're running to Egypt away from King Herod. And so biblical hope is rooted in who God is, not on the circumstances that are swirling around us. You see, hope is only as good as the object you place it in. Your hope is only as good as the object that you place your trust or your confidence, your hopeful expectations in. Biblical hope places its hope, its trust, its confident expectation in God's faithfulness. Your hope is only as good as the object in which you place your confidence and trust. And the Old Testament prophets were unshakable because their hope was placed in the right object. The New Testament opens with Israel's hope, a tense expectation waiting on God to bring about the Messiah. Israel had been waiting. They had been kavaying and yakaling, waiting and hoping for the moment that the Messiah would come. The prophets had declared it, and it was God's past faithfulness that enabled hope to wait expectantly for its fulfillment. And so when we look to the New Testament, we see a people waiting with expectation because their hope is rooted in God's faithfulness, not their present circumstances, because they're being dominated by the Romans. For generations, they had been waiting. And that brings us to Luke chapter 2. Please turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 2 now. We're going to be looking at verse 22. The angels have been sent to Mary and Joseph. They've had their child, Jesus. The angels have appeared to the shepherds who were watching their fields at night and proclaimed the goodness of God's plan of salvation that was accomplished in the person of Jesus. And for hundreds of years, Israel had been waiting for this very moment. They had been kavaing. They had been yakaling. They had been waiting and hoping for the Messiah to come, and he had arrived. And 40 days after the birth of Jesus, it was time for Mary and Joseph to take him up to the temple to dedicate him to the Lord and offer a sacrifice. And we pick up the story in Luke chapter 2, verse 22. And I want to look specifically at a person named Simeon that Mary and Joseph run into at the temple, because Simeon was waiting for the moment that the Messiah would arrive. We read in Luke 2, verse 22, when the time came for the purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Verse 25, now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Let's just stop there and pause there for a moment. Here we are introduced to Simeon. Jesus has been born. The region of Bethlehem is celebrating this mysterious birth. The shepherd had gone and witnessed baby Jesus being born. The angels and the heavenly host had appeared to them, and news of this had surrounded that region, and it's only 5 miles away from Jerusalem. But when Mary and Joseph bring their baby, there is a man named Simeon who, like the rest of the Israelites, was hoping and waiting and longing for the arrival of the Messiah. And we are told that Simeon is described as righteous and a devout man. Some think that he might have been a priest because he conducts the ceremony for them, but we're not told that in Scripture. We don't know. But Simeon knew all of the Old Testament promises. Simeon would have been aware of all the prophecies about the coming of the Messiah. And Simeon even had a personal promise from God that he would see his salvation. We're told of that in verse 26, that it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. So here we are introduced to this man who is displaying a biblical hope, a confident expectation that he would in fact see God's plan of salvation before his departure from this earth. When I read these passages, I wonder to myself, at what age did God reveal that to Simeon? Simeon's described as a righteous and devout man. Was it when he was a teenager that the Holy Spirit made it clear to him, you will see the Messiah before you die? How long had Simeon been waiting for this moment? How many babies had come into the temple? Did he know it was going to be a child? How many years had he been lingering, waiting, yakaling, kavaing, and hoping that today was the day? Did Simeon ever have prayers or conversations with God that said, Lord, I'm getting well along in years. I'm starting to creep into the age where people come to meet you face to face. Maybe you could introduce the Messiah today. How long, how many years had he been waiting for this promise to be fulfilled, holding on to a promise revealed to him by the Holy Spirit? But Simeon could have hope. He could wait with confidence because God's past faithfulness that we have recorded in Scripture, God's past faithfulness to his people enabled Simeon to wait expectantly for the promise that the Holy Spirit had made to him to be fulfilled. We read in verse 27, the next passage, moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. I love that statement, moved by the Spirit. Mary and Joseph have come to engage in a ceremony that lots of other parents would have come to engage in. And it's go time. Simeon is moved by the Spirit. This righteous and devout man is moved by the Spirit to encounter Jesus. He went into the temple courts, we are told. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. Lord, as you have promised me, I am now witnessing and staring into the eyes of the Messiah. How long had Simeon been waiting for this moment? How long had he endured life under Herod the not so great? How long had he endured under the time of the Romans? What type of trials or tribulations came into his path that made him question this hope being fulfilled? But this man is now holding the consolation of Israel, the consolation of humanity. The Prince of Peace is in his arms. What was that like for him? All of his waiting fulfilled. Maybe you're here this morning and God has promised you something and you're waiting and you're hoping, but it isn't coming to pass in the time that you thought it would. Maybe you're finding yourself in a difficult circumstance, similar to the countless people in Scripture that find themselves in difficult circumstances, but your hope is fixed on God. Your hope is placed in the right object. And we are reminded in Scripture that Abraham waited for 25 years before the birth of Isaac. Joseph waited in Potiphar's prison for years before God's purposes came to pass. King David waited for God to tell him when the time was for him to step into his rightful kingly reign. We need to wait expectantly. Biblical hope consists of waiting, but we can have peace while we wait because we remember God's past faithfulness and it enables us to wait patiently. Simeon waits and his hopes are fulfilled because the one who promised is faithful. So when we say, as God's people, that we hope in God, it isn't wishful thinking. It is rooted in the faithfulness of who he is and his past demonstration of that faithfulness. Israel had been waiting for hundreds of years for the Messiah to arrive. Psalm 130 that we read earlier promised that God himself would come to redeem Israel. So when Mary and Joseph place baby Jesus into his arms, he is staring into the eyes of the very one that Psalm 130 verse 8 spoke about. Look at these two verses contrasted. Simeon saw it came to pass. In Psalm 130 verse 8 we read, he himself, speaking of the Lord, God himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. And Simeon, generations, hundreds of years later, promised that he would witness the Messiah come. In Luke chapter 2, verse 30, says this, my eyes have seen your salvation. Psalm 130, I wait for the Lord. My hope is in his word, his promises, and Simeon is witnessing firsthand. He is staring into the eyes of God's promised plan. Isn't that good news? The New Testament authors continued to build on the biblical concept of hope, and they use the word elpis. Elpis literally means expectation, trust, confidence. The New Testament authors always centered the word elpis on the person and work of Jesus. It was a hope that was rooted in the finished work of Christ. It was used 48 times in the New Testament, often referring to the joyful expectation of the believer for salvation. Let me just give you one example. Peter, in his epistle, speaks of a living hope, a living elpis. He speaks of new birth. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, this is how Peter puts it. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So when the New Testament authors used the word hope, they married it, they connected it. The object of their hope was Christ himself, his finished work. And that is the hope that has come to the world. That is the hope that is extended to every human being at Christmas time, that you can rest, you can place all your hopes in the finished work and person of Jesus Christ, and you will experience a living hope on the inside of you. The life of God returned to you. That's the miracle of Christmas. The New Testament authors rooted their hope in the person of Christ. And when your hope is rooted in Christ, you are secure. Because his past faithfulness provides us the confidence, even when present circumstances might be difficult. So let me ask you this morning, where is your hope placed? What have you placed your hope in? Every year at Christmas, we are reminded that the hope of the world is not an object, but a person. But we forget that sometimes in our culture. I was at the mall the other week with my wife. We were doing our Christmas shopping, and as I walked into the mall, I see parents, and to be honest, they looked burdened and harassed and helpless. They're got a few kids in tow and lots of packages, and they're hurried. There's a frantic pace to get to the store to search for the perfect kids so that they can make their kids happy. Meanwhile, the kid's screaming the whole time while they're doing this. And there's this wonderful Christmas music that's piped over the speakers. Isn't it always the way? You're wearing your winter coat inside, you're sweaty, you're hot, and it's declaring that it's the most wonderful time of the year. And as I watched all these parents pursuing the perfect gift for their child who's in tow crying, I remember that feeling at Christmas morning. I remember being a child, and I am grateful for all the time that my parents spent looking for the perfect gift for me. I remember being a child, and I was always hopeful that I would get a certain gift. I can't remember a Christmas where I wasn't confidently expecting, trusting, hoping that a certain gift would be under the tree. And I was that kid at Christmas who was high octane. Like, I was jacked up on sugar cookies and I was freaking out, man, because I was so excited waiting for my hopes to be fulfilled. I remember one Christmas, I was so hopped up on sugar, I ran up the stairs to our upstairs level, and I was running so fast that I didn't realize the stairs ended. So I just projected myself like 6 feet into the air. And then when I landed on the floor eventually, because I ran out of stairs, down beneath me, the light fixture that was hanging on the roof, because I landed on the floor so hard, actually fell from the roof and smashed on the floor. That was high-octane childhood right there. And I remember every Christmas morning, I'd be waiting for that gift. I'd be confidently expecting it. I might even be naming and claiming it. And I was just waiting for it. And my hopes were wrapped up in a gift. And sure enough, Christmas morning would come, and more often than not, that gift that the infomercials had told me would change my life, that beautifully marketed thing that looked so cool on TV, would be under the Christmas tree. And I would open it and I'd go outside and I'd start to play with whatever it is. And I would only discover that the marketing and the infomercials made it look really cool and easy to do. But that wasn't my experience on Christmas morning. But I would still give it my best because I was a high-octane Christmas child. And I'd be looking for that thing to satisfy my deepest needs because all my hopes were placed within that object. And it might make me happy and it might make me feel good and I would enjoy it, but that feeling would eventually wear off. The feeling never lasted. It would satisfy, but only for a while. But then that sense of joy, that hope, that expectation would dissipate and quickly fade away. And as a child, my heart would find some other object to start to hope for. You know, as adults, we can follow the same patterns we did as children. As adults, we can place our hope in things. We can place our hopes in that next relationship, hoping that it'll make us happy. We can place our hope in material items. We can hope that something or someone will make us happy. We can hope that it will fulfill us, but your hope is only as good as the object you place it in. And when our hope is placed in something, in an object or a gift at Christmas, it can satisfy us for a while. But if it is a misplaced hope, then the longing for that real, deep, soul-satisfying hope comes back with even greater force. We are told in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 12, there's this little nugget of wisdom in the midst of this chapter. And in Proverbs 13, verse 12, we read this: hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. Now, I just want to approach that verse with a certain paradigm shift to it. I just want to apply that verse's principle to the ultimate hope every human being longs to have fulfilled. When our hope is rooted in something temporary, when it is placed within something that is material, when we are looking to that thing or a relationship or a new job to fulfill our deepest longings, it is a hope that has impossible expectations attached to it. Because that object was never meant to satisfy our deepest needs. Our deepest longings can only be satisfied in Christ Jesus himself. We were made to be in relationship with the one who created us. We were made to be in relationship with God himself in the person of Jesus Christ. So when we place our hope in objects other than Christ, our deepest hope gets deferred because the object we placed our hope in couldn't satisfy our deepest needs. It was a temporary hope filler. And when we do this many times over, it is Proverbs 13, verse 12, on repeat. It is a hope deferred that makes our heart sick. And then we search for the next thing to attach our hopes to. And when that doesn't satisfy, it makes our heart sick again. And then our hope looks for something to latch onto. And when that person or thing doesn't satisfy, our hope continues to search because our hope continually is being deferred. And that's the danger we can even slip into in our Western culture's perspective of hope. we can always be attaching it to a material object because materialism is a counterfeit God in our day. There is only one hope. There is only one object that we can place our hope in that will satisfy our deepest longings and will become a tree of life, and it is the person of Jesus Christ. That is why the New Testament authors always spoke of El Peace, always spoke of hope in connection with the person of Jesus. He is the hope that everybody is so desperately, desperately searching for. And the real hope at Christmas that people are searching for is in fact calling out to them. When I was standing in that mall watching people harassed and helpless, burdened, carrying all their gifts and all their items, desperately seeking for hope, desperately seeking for purpose or meaning, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 came into my mind. And I saw the hope of the world standing in that mall and saying to people, "Come to me. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened." Man, did I see weary, burdened people at Christmas time. It can be the most frantic pace that we observe in our calendar year. And Jesus, the hope of the world, says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke. Take my teachings. Take who I am. Connect yourself to me, take my yoke upon you, and learn from me." Look at how he describes himself. "For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." When Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary," he is inviting us into a living hope that Peter describes. When he says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest," he is inviting us into a living hope, a hope that is secure because it is rooted in him. It is a hope that is certain because it is resting in him. Biblical hope isn't wishful thinking or sentimental feeling that something's going to come true. Biblical hope is rooted in the knowledge of facts. Biblical hope is rooted in the fact that God's promises of all of the Old Testament came to fulfillment in the person of Christ. The long-awaited hope of the world came true when Simeon held it in his arms. Biblical hope is the fact that Jesus came to give his life as a ransom to cure our salvation, that he himself would redeem us from all our sins. And biblical hope is the fact that our hope lies in heaven and intercedes on our behalf, that this Jesus who died on the cross for our sins was buried and resurrected and went into the heavenly throne room and now resides in the temple as our great high priest. That is the hope of the believer. It's not in a Christmas gift wrapped up under a tree, because that is a temporary hope. Our hope is in heaven, living, praying, interceding on our behalf. That is a much better hope, is it not, at Christmas? Biblical hope is an anchor that is secure in the Holy of Holies. We are told this in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19. We have this hope, the reality of who Christ is. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain where our forerunner, Jesus, has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever. That is where the Christian's hope resides. A couple weeks ago, I talked about the painful things that come into our lives and that there's room for your pain at Christmas, and that sometimes for many people, the Christmas season is just like you're trying to hold on to hope. But did you realize that if you have placed your faith in Christ while you're trying to hold on to hope, that hope, in fact, is holding on to you? He carries you when you're weak. He sees your present circumstances, and you can rest secure that his past faithfulness to you is a reminder that he will carry you through whatever circumstances you find yourself in. We can rest secure because our hope lives in heaven and intercedes on our behalf. Our hope is our high priest forever. And the hope of the world cries out to all mankind this Christmas, come to me. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you the rest you're so desperately seeking for. I will give you rest. It is rooted in him. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me. I am gentle and humble. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. This Christmas, if you find yourself weary and burdened, it is time to rediscover and place your hope in the person of Jesus Christ. Because our hope is only as good as the object that it is placed in. The only thing that can satisfy your deepest longings is Christ himself. When we talk of biblical hope, it isn't wishful thinking or sentimental feeling that something may or may not happen. It is rooted and rests on the confidence of God's faithfulness expressed in the person of Jesus Christ. That is the believer's hope, and it is eternal. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this indescribable gift. This hope of the world that satisfies everything inside of us. But we thank you that as we place our hope in you, it is firm and secure because you are faithful. I pray for anyone here this morning that does not know this hope personally, this hope held out in the person of Jesus Christ, that they would be drawn to you just as you led Simeon to Christ. May you lead them now to discover who Jesus is, the fulfilled promise. We pray this in his name. Amen.
Many well-known people in the Bible had to wait years to see God's promises come to pass. Noah, Abraham, Moses. Their faith was tested as they learned to wait expectantly, trusting the character and faithfulness of God. Simeon knew about the prophecies of the Messiah and had his own conviction from the Holy Spirit that he would see the Christ before he died. Would we have given up, thinking perhaps we didn't hear correctly? Would we have lost hope under the tyranny of the Roman Empire? But on that day when God let him hold the Prince of Peace, Simeon knew he could die fulfilled. We can have the same hope as we wait for God to bring healing to our pain or a breakthrough in our circumstances. Even if we feel we can barely hold on to hope, Christ is holding on to us.
With hope, there is always love.
I hope for health.
Every day I wake up with the hope.
Without hope, what do we have?
And the Christmas story is a real story that contains the struggle between hope and despair, between life and death, between healing and hurting.
In this series called Hope, Brett McBride encourages us to never give up, but wait for God. Whatever situation we may be in, he will never leave us nor forsake us.
Despite whatever circumstances or anxieties you're holding, the hope of the world lives within you.
This series by Brett McBride is available on CD and DVD. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call 1-416-222-3341. Extension 289. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca.
Our hope is in heaven, living, praying, interceding on our behalf. That is a much better hope, is it not, at Christmas?
Savior was born on Christmas Day. to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. From God our Heavenly Father, a blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. How that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Now to the Lord sing praises, within this place, and with true love and brotherhood, each other now embrace. This holy tide of Christmas, all others doth deface. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Comfort and joy. Joy, comfort and joy, and comfort and joy, comfort and joy.
The People's Church Basketball Ministry in Toronto, Canada, seeks to help young men between the ages of 12 to 17 years develop in every area of their life. This is the story of People's Basketball.
The Basketball Ministries, People specifically, has been around for about 4 years. The ministry does encompass the physical, life skills for sure, because we are pushing them hard to focus on their education and to give them insights into life.
I think it definitely helped me for my development as a person and as a basketball player. Obviously, we do the training and stuff like that, but they also teach you how to grow as a person, like how to talk to people, how to do stuff outside of basketball. It's gonna help me with my life.
Oh, this is People's Basketball is one of the greatest programs that I've been a part of, you know, and I've been a part of a lot of programs. We have the homework club, we have tutoring, we have, you know, we guide their path to success, we bring in mentors to talk to them every month, so they're getting that holistic approach, not just here's a ball, go play. And that is what, you know, I take pride in about this program.
What I like best about People is that they're everyone on the team, from the coaches, the parents, the people behind the scenes that we don't know about, are always supportive.
Basketball is just a vehicle that's used to help these young men grow and succeed. We bring in guest speakers that talk to them about their lives, what's important 10 years from now that they can't see today, and encourage them to go on and finish school. Encourage them that only through education will they truly be successful.
When I think about the church and the role of the church, my mind goes to Matthew 28, where Jesus tells all Christians, all disciples, to go into the world and preach and teach the gospel to those who haven't heard it. One of the things about the people's basketball team is that it is a reflection of us going into the world. And if through teaching them and enhancing their basketball skills, we can also teach them the love of Jesus Christ, then I just think that's a wonderful thing.
I thank God that everywhere He's with me on the basketball court. I'll have to be scared or I have to be nervous, because whoever goes down, He's with me.
The life lessons you sort of learn here, they apply throughout everywhere. We learn such important things like teamwork and just skills you can apply on and off the court that are really important to me and all the guys on the team here.
We all have something in common, and it's basketball, so we all just make it work. So we joke around, we do everything together, so it's easy.
I think our kids watch our example. We're all Christians. The volunteers are all Christians. The coaches are, like any Christian, to a greater or lesser extent. But we have the privilege to be able to preach the gospel through our actions and our example.
Do we have all the answers?
No.
Do we have all the questions?
No.
What do we have is we have a tool that's going to allow you to investigate who you are and grow and build as a person. And that's our main goal, right? What we want to do is make these young boys into men and grow from there. You know, we want good character kids, and that's what we got so far.
So before playing basketball here for People's Church, I was just your average high school kid playing basketball on the school team. After being here for about a year, I've actually been accepted to all the schools I've applied to, and it's actually great now that I get to choose where I'd like to go post-secondary and actually get the opportunity to play basketball, which is great.
God is everywhere, He's everything, He's part of our lives. So in basketball, we just assume that God is guiding these boys. We pray for them all the time. We ask them to pray for each other. So while they're playing the game, we try and make them aware that everything about the game and themselves and their success and their life is God-centered.
Really find, like, I can focus when I'm praying, and even sometimes on the court, I'll find myself slowing down, saying myself a few words, and I find it really helps out with my game.
It is a church thing, but that's not all it is. It's more than that. It's for you. It's to make you better at everything that you do in life.
It's countless hours of volunteerism. It's countless hours of checking in with the kids. It's, hey, this young man has an issue. Can someone reach out to him? Not one time do any of the coaches or mentors say, can I get something back? Because the reward is seeing that kid on the court, seeing that kid smile, seeing that young man do well.
Everyone's caring, everyone's loving, everyone's supporting each other, and everyone just has a common goal.
Basketball means teamwork.
Basketball means family.
And basketball means everything to me.
And basketball means everything to me.
There are many things we could put our hope in today. Material things, relationships, a great career move, or even our children. But these things only postpone our deepest hope, because these things can't satisfy us indefinitely. True hope can only be found in the person of Jesus Christ. He's the one who gives us life, peace, and rest from the burdens we're carrying. As Christians, that is where our hope lies. Join us again for more clear biblical teaching here on Living Truth.
To watch this message again, visit our website, download transcripts, order DVDs and CDs, as well as our daily devotional, or sign up for our monthly newsletter. Online, you can sign up for podcasts. You can also join us on Facebook and YouTube.
Next week, a new year and a new series from Brett McBride called Rethinking Religion. On behalf of Living Truth, we wish you a blessed new year.
To see pa rum pa pum pum. Our finest gifts we bring, pa-pum-pa-pum-pum. Too late before the king, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum. So to honor him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. When we come, little baby, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. I am a poor boy too, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. I have no gifts to bring, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. That's fit to give the king, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Shall I pray for you, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, on my drum? Mary nodded, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. The ox and lamb kept time, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. I paid my drum for him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. I paid my best for him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum. Then he smiled at me, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. He and my drum, he and my drum. My drum, being my drum.
Your generous contributions support the work of Living Truth, the media ministry of the People's Church Toronto. We are committed to the highest level of transparency and accountability. If any approved project target has been met, the remaining contributions will be used where most needed, as determined by Living Truth.